Everybody ready?
Yep.
Let's go.
Ahsoka!
Four Midwest Guys presents Star Wars Rebels HQ.
Battles leave scores. Some you can't see.
The holocron. I'm afraid it's changing him.
I will never let my friends get hurt again.
Your anger gives you strength.
Governor Price, these rebels have proven particularly stubborn. How do you intend to solve this problem?
I need someone who sees a bigger picture.
To defeat an enemy, you must know them. Not simply their battle tactics. But their history, philosophy, art.
I must become more powerful.
Split the treasure.
Oh, that's a classic.
One last glorious day in the Grand Army of the Republic.
Jedi and Sith, the light and the dark.
They'll be the architect. Of their own destruction.
The key to destroying the Sith.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Four Midwest Guys Presents Star Wars Rebels HQ. Tonight, we'll be reviewing Season 3, Episode 3. We'll get to that in a minute. The title of the episode, though, is The Holocrons of Fate. With me today is Mr. Brian Eckenbauer.
Yeah, what's up,
what's going on, B? And my brother Aaron's back as well.
Yeah, how's it going, man?
How's it going, man? All right, guys, so this is actually Episode 3, not Episode 2. Technically, the first episode is actually a Part 1 and a Part 2. They just put them together for the premiere. So we actually had... Later in the week,
they actually put them out as separate episodes.
So, reality, this is Episode 3. So, if you're confused, yes, last week was technically Episodes 1 and 2. Just happened to be called... I forget the name of the episode, but... that's pretty bad. But anyway, so we're on to Episode 3, Season 3, Holocrons of Fate. Let's just get into it, guys. So this opens up with basically the attack of the ship. There's attack on one of those old freighter ships that they got in the season two.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess right off the bat we see before they get there, they're actually Ezra's still wanting that Sith holocron, still asking about it. Where is it? What'd you do with it?
Where's it at?
He's still kind of tempted, I guess, by the dark side.
Yeah, he's still thinking it's kind of useful in his own way. It's like, I still picked up some things from it. There might be another trick or two.
Yeah. Where'd you do with it? Where's it at?
Yeah.
Huh, Dad?
Yeah.
Where's it at? So, but yeah, obviously, he goes on, you know, we could use those secrets to destroy the Sith. Obviously, Kanan, secrets almost destroyed you, which is another piece of our trailer. Season premiere trailer. Mm-hmm. So again, we're seeing even more of the trailer already.
Yeah, pretty much by the time we get to the end of the episode, we've seen a good 80% of the trailer.
Yeah, and again, I'm pleased with that though, you know, because that leaves surprise and.
Oh yeah, it definitely leaves room for them to do more things mid season towards the end. I was just kind of expecting like what we saw in the trailer almost to be kind of spread out a bit more till about the mid season point.
Yeah. Just makes me wonder what they got in store for us for midseason, because there's a big... Because obviously we've got Rogue One coming up, so I would just wonder.
Yeah, it might play into that a little bit, and that would make sense. Mm-hmm. Either that or we have a couple more episodes that kind of feel a bit more like filler. Mm-hmm. Maybe a few more Callus episodes.
I don't consider the Callus episode filler. There's only one episode I consider filler, and we all know what that is. There's no need to bring it up.
Which one's that?
No, we're not doing it. We all know it's the episode. Our listeners who listened to the past podcast will know what it is. No need to bring it up.
What if they only heard one?
Fine, get it out of the way.
The Squale episode?
The Squale episode.
Yeah.
Other than that,
I feel to disagree. I feel like the Squale episode will be integral.
Yeah, I mean, it has to be, right? Because that's like the beginning of Lightspeed.
Not only is the beginning of Lightspeed, that's really the first time you see Ezra really connecting with, like, other creatures outside of, like, the one giant spider thing.
Well, he did it with the little doll cat, too, and stuff like that.
With a cat.
Yeah.
This was a Squale.
All right.
It was a giant beast.
Okay. All right. Enough about Squales.
Capable of, you know, destroying entire ships.
All right. I'm done talking about Squales. All right.
I'm sorry, they need to be in one of the Star Wars films at some point in the future.
How awesome would that be if they were in Rogue One?
That would be funny, actually. You just see it flying by.
All right.
Just a lone square.
A cameo.
Oh, boy. Enough, gentlemen.
Admittedly, it would make Rogue One a little bit more interesting if it's just there in the background somewhere, just solidifying the canon that has been created by Star Wars Rebels.
Only if the Death Star test fires on one and blows it.
Trust me, if I see it in that movie, I'm standing up and be like, "Squill!"
Oh my god! All right, so we also I've been asking myself this question, and our fans have heard me talk in past podcasts. Why would Yoda send them there? Ezra finally puts that out there a little bit. He asks that question. Well, why would Master Yoda send us to Malachor if he didn't want us to use a Sith holocron? We finally get an answer from Kanan. We were given the chance to defeat them, but we failed. So, do you guys think that this is Filoni's way of trying to answer fan? Is he doing a little fan service here, or is this...
It's probably solidifying, like, why that is in the plot, and that way you don't have that kind of coming up in the future too heavily.
Yeah, you don't have people...
At the same time, it does seem like kind of just a quick little, we're going to write that into where that's the answer.
Yeah. Right. That's why I was going to say the same thing.
Same thing. Okay. All right, so let's move on to the holocron, well, it is a hologram, conversation with Maul. We hear Ezra's first thing, "You betrayed me." Maul, being the typical Sith, says, "I didn't betray you. I only betrayed your friends. I would have remained loyal to you." So another example of a Sith always trying to tell the truth without telling the whole truth.
I don't know. Is Maul still considered a Sith at this point? Or is he just like a Dark Force user?
He's just a Dark Force user, I would say. He's not officially a Sith or a Dark.
But I would say he still has the same thinking pattern as a Sith.
Yeah,
that's fair.
So, you know, the Sith are always... saying, well, we never lie. Well, they never tell the whole truth either, but...
So it's, by your idea, it's like lying by omission?
Yeah, thing. Pretty much, yeah. That's kind of how they
operate. Deceit by omission?
Precisely, so...
Half-truths?
Exactly, half-truths, precisely. Or just not telling everything.
Yeah.
Yep. So, he's holding Hera, he's holding Zeb, and he's holding Sabine hostage. And he wants not just the Sith holocron, but he also wants the Jedi holocron as well.
Mm-hmm. Right, but it's all set up because they were trying to get a hold of the ghost.
Right.
And they couldn't get a hold of him, and then all of a sudden they did. It was Hera. Yep. Like, oh, Hera, thank God we got a hold of you. Somebody knows where... And then you find out it's Maul that knows exactly where they were.
Well, yeah, because up until that point, they actually were assuming it was like another Inquisitor.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And it was... Because it looked like it when they got on the ship too. It looked like they're like a bunch of stormtroopers or something, but apparently it was just Maul.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, apparently Maul also had like a couple of droids that you see later on that are like guard bots sort of things.
Yeah, we can talk about. Well, let's get it out of the way. I thought that was one of the only few problems I had with the episode was his little guard bot.
It was a weird thing.
We're like Johnny Five meets, I don't know.
I don't remember
1980s cartoons. Or
yeah, I don't remember that design anywhere before.
There's something similar in episode one, but not with the face, obviously. The face reminds me of something you saw on TV when you're watching cartoons as a kid. I don't know, in the 80s.
Yeah.
You're like, danger, Will Robinson, danger.
I don't know, apparently he's just running low on cash. He had to get the really cheap models off the pawn shop.
There was the two cars that flew, and they had like little faces that talked. One was blue, one was red. I can't remember the name of the show. But those faces
remind.
It was a cartoon on in the 80s.
Flying cars?
I have to look it up.
But like Speed Buggy? They flew.
Yeah, there was one red, one blue, and they talked. And those faces, like the robots had, very similar.
Okay. Is it anything like the Jetson cars? Or
No, they were regular cars, but they changed into flying cars. And they had it was kind of like they had their own kits. Except the kit, instead of being a light, actually was a face that talked and moved.
Oh, okay.
Just like those robots. It looks just like
them. Oh, okay.
That's what it reminded me of. I was like, holy crap, that, you know, he totally stole that. But
he borrowed from it, you know.
You're right. I can't remember the name of the show for the life of me. But one was a guy, he drove the blue car, and the girl, they were brother and sister, I think, and the sister had the red car.
Dude,
and
I've watched a lot of old, like, Toonami this was, this and, like, is old. Barbera stuff. We're talking, I do like, not remember this.
Vintage 80s, dude. I mean, this is right in the
that
time.
That sounds very 80s, it goes, actually, yeah.
It was on at the same time, I think, like, Mask was on, and...
Is it the one that the guy turned into?
No.
That turned into a motorcycle or something, didn't it?
No.
Or is it a car?
And it wasn't Mask.
No, it wasn't Mask. It was two... They're, like, brother and sister, and they... It was like...
It was one of the most forgettable cartoons of the
80s, until I saw those faces and then jogged my memory. And I was like, oh, yeah, I've seen that before. But we're kind of going off on a way off on a
tangent here. Hey, man, at least we're not green like Hong Kong Fooey versus Care Bears. Who wins?
I'll look it up and I'll try to put it on the next episode, maybe. I don't know if it's worth it. It's
probably something we don't need to be that concerned.
There are probably
about.
People out there listening that listen to this and go screaming at the at their computers and their iPads and their whatever they're listening to.
Like, how could you forgot it? It was a cult classic.
Yeah.
The GoBots?
No, not the GoBots.
Wasn't it like a Transformers spinoff?
Yeah. It was on the same time as Transformers. It was like a cheap ripoff. Although there are some people still like GoBots, I can't say nothing.
Yeah, I'm looking, I don't see it.
I thought they eventually built that in the canon, like of like the Transformers universe, where like they were like the little tiny bots that like assisted the Transformers.
No, they were the rival company.
Oh, okay, so I'm thinking of something completely different.
Yeah, you're thinking of the heads that would transform.
Yeah, like little mini bots.
Headmasters or whatever, yeah. I forget.
Anyway, All right. It's not important.
Let's move on. So, Maul gets a tour of the Ghost. Maul discovers that the ship is, it's not just their ship, but it's actually their home.
Yeah.
He's looking at one of Sabine's paintings, I think.
Yeah, like some of the graffiti on the wall or something.
Right, and he kind of makes Hera, you know, you have to, I insist, you give me a tour.
Yeah, well, I mean, she doesn't
literally
really want to,
but lightsaber.
There is that kind of thing. You are kind of a hostage here, so... Kind of have to.
No, I have to. I insist, really. Yeah. And I did like his comment to Sabine during that whole thing where he goes,
you especially should trust me. I used to rule your people.
Right back to season 5 of Clone Wars. That was a nice nod.
And you even have that conversation between Zeb and Sabine afterwards. Like, is that true? And she's like, yeah.
Yeah.
That happened. Yeah. We don't like to talk about it.
Yeah, so it was a very nice reference and a nice throwback, I thought. You know, nice little nod.
Well, I mean, that was kind of a fun, you know, little arc in the Clone Wars as well.
Great,
so
great arc.
Yeah.
One of the best arcs.
Yeah, it's actually up there. So, I mean, it was nice to kind of see a throwback to it.
So, you know, it's also kind of setting us up for a return to Mandalore maybe this season. What do you guys think? You think we're going to go back to Mandalore?
Yeah, a lot of it.
Yeah.
Or at the very least, you're going to see a lot of interactions with Mandalorians, and I think you'll probably see Sabine taking a bigger role as well.
Yeah, I think it'll
Because, I mean, if you look at the jump between last season and this one, Sabine, along with Ezra, both changed pretty heavily, so.
Yeah, do you think Maul's going to
at least stylistically.
You think they'll involve Maul again, or you think it'll be something else?
I wouldn't be surprised if they did.
Because he's obviously got a past and a history with them. So.
Yeah, I mean, that nice scene... I mean, since we're already seeing Maul, and he played a large part in last season as well, mm-hmm. I wouldn't be surprised if he's at least playing an integral part until mid-season.
Yeah. So, he gets his tour, and I found a few comical lines here I thought were pretty funny. Zeb's room, what an interesting smell. Yep.
It's a polite way of saying it, isn't it?
Yeah, right? And Sabine's room, how colorful. He's playing the snob role. And then he gets to Kane's room. Ah, yes. The dull and dour. This is a Jedi's chamber. You know, I don't know.
It does seem kinda, the way a Sith would think about a Jedi,
think about
doesn't
a Jedi,
it?
Yeah, boring, dull. Yep, this is it. This is the place.
It's functional. Give you that.
Yeah. Okay. I do like... And then in Kanan's room, I like... he uses Kanan's real name. He goes, or should I say, Caleb Doom, which is they're part of the comic strip, and it's even the book. Because I read the book. I haven't read the comics. I haven't read the Kanan comic, but I did read Something Dawn. I'm really bad with names today, but anyway, it was like the Rebel precursor book. Before the series came out, and I read that.
Did he play an integral part in that book as well?
Yeah, and it goes about, you know, how he gave up being a Jedi, and when he did that, he took on the name Kanan Jarrus. It goes even more depth, I hear, in the comic book.
Yeah, but I would assume it has to a little bit, because the comic's been running for a bit, I think.
Yeah, but his name as an actual Padawan in the Jedi Academy is Caleb Doom.
Mm-hmm.
That's his actual name. So,
Doom. Pole position.
Pole position, that's it. That's totally it.
And I found it.
Cool, there you go. So the robots are from Pole Position, their faces.
That is a horrible name for a show about talking.
Yeah, because they would race. That's right. Yes. Totally. Nice job, Mr. Ankerbot.
Like, that sounds like a show about strippers. Like, yes, just from the title.
Yes, just from the strippers, but no, it was totally...
But there was also a video game.
Was it?
Pole Position.
Is that what it was?
Yeah.
Okay. That sounds...
So it was like a cartoon tie-in to advertise the game sort of thing?
Yeah, probably. It was probably... They probably got the idea from the video game.
Yeah.
Because that was one of the original race car games that you could play.
Yeah, so that's like the same way there was like an Earthworm Jim game, yeah. And there was a cartoon that came out afterwards.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so pulling it back to Star Wars, now that we... But thanks for the pole position there. The other thing I liked about this scene, I don't know what you guys thought, is I liked how he used the Force on Hera to get the information of where that Jedi holocron was.
Yeah, it was a nice scene, and it was a nice touch kind of seeing him use his Force abilities. And
yeah, well, to me, I mean, it was like automatically first thing I thought of was Episode 7 and Kylo Ren and Poe Dameron. I don't know. What did you think, Brian, of that whole scene?
Yeah, it resembled that very much so. Like, it was the probing of the brain to find the information that he was looking for, and like almost like a tie into that, or the tie into the Luke Vader scene where your thoughts betray you, blah blah blah.
Right, exactly. Yeah. You have a sister. So I like that. We have seen the Jedi use it in the Clone Wars, the whole thing, but usually they do it in a group, and it's much more passive. Mm. Obviously, the Sith are much more violent with it.
Well, they're much more aggressive.
Yeah, I was saying much more invasive.
And we did see Anakin try to use it in the Clone Wars, and then he reverted to using, when the rest of the Jedi weren't around, he actually used the Force choke, which was a nice precursor. So,
see the Force choke?
Force choke. Choke.
He's like,
I'm going to make you laugh until you forget.
Like, I'm trying to read your mind. Knock, knock.
Who's that?
The Force. It's a Force joke.
You will die. You will tell me what you want, or you will die from laughter. No. All right. So the Bendu returns. So the Bendu and the trial to regain balance.
Could be trail.
Could be.
They were going down the one little.
Yeah. All right. Well. Either way. So.
It's you can go with it either way, it's fine.
So let's talk about the start of the scene. The Bendu's actually tiptoeing around these guys this whole scene, and he's like huge.
Yeah.
So I mean,
I don't know if he was tiptoeing around them.
Well, he was going around.
Like, it's very like Bugs Bunny-ish there for a second. Like, it's kind of right behind the back sort of thing.
Right, but I don't think he ever moved.
Well,
because he just kind of blends in with the scenery, and they walk right past him. They didn't realize he was there.
Well, maybe it's that. I don't. But yeah, he picks up that whole.
Well,
sensor
just from like the angles of how they were shooting it, it does kind of make it give the perception that it is.
He's moving,
kind of moving very quickly without them noticing,
without them sensing it.
I didn't see. I saw it as he was just kind of like hunched over, like we saw before.
Yeah.
But he was really quiet, and when they walked past him, then he kind of got up and.
Well, the funny thing is, like, you have that scene contrasted by when they actually see him, like, wake up, and it's very slow. You see, like, dust coming off him. Like, it almost looks like he's been settled and just sleeping for, like, since you've seen him last.
Yeah, that's why I thought that.
Well, it also begs the question, though. Do you think there's more than one, maybe?
No.
You think he's the
only
one?
No, I think that's why it's the Bendu, and not...
Not...
A Bendu.
A Bendu, or his name is Bendu.
Because I have done a little bit of, you know... Back and forth. Apparently, the Bendu is a race.
Is it?
You've done Bendu research?
I've done a little research on the Bendu, yeah. And apparently, at least in the extended universe, there is a Bendu race.
Really? I thought there was like a group that actually like followed like the Bendu or something like that. Like in the extended universe.
Yeah, I don't know much about the group, you know, beyond that, other than that they are apparently a race.
Okay.
Or at least they used to be. I don't know.
Fair enough.
They're
Force sensitive creatures. Yeah, obviously they've been gone for a while.
So it's just one.
This is the first time we've run into.
So this is the last one.
Possibly.
Yeah. That's what I would think.
Or they're just really scattered.
I mean, so it makes sense the way there'd be a race because he is a he is a creature, so there's probably more than one of him, or used to be.
Yeah.
Right. So now he, and it wouldn't be, I wouldn't put it past Filoni to make him the last of his kind.
You think he killed the other Bendu?
He went in a rage. Just
or maybe they were hunted.
I mean, since he's what we're calling a gray Jedi-ish.
Well,
maybe he was. Maybe he knows both sides, and he killed the rest of the Bendu.
If I was a Sith user, I would want to kill these guys. Even if they're gray, they'd still be in my way, maybe, in helping out the Jedi. You know,
I'd want them dead. Neutral to helping out the Jedi.
Or maybe they'd hunt them down to try to, you know, use them.
Well, I think they would hunt them down because they can use both sides of the Force.
Precisely, yeah.
And the Sith would feel that makes them stronger than them.
Well, that, I mean, we have seen the Sith hunting down Force-sensitive kids, so, I mean, it'd probably be in the same...
Yeah, I could easily see that.
Grouping as
well. Yeah, like a genocide kind of thing by the Sith, maybe. Who knows? So the Bendu obviously says, the Jedi returns, then this time with his student, perhaps to talk, ha ha ha. He kind of laughs, which I thought was kind of funny.
Yeah, he's very just nonchalant and kind of just passive about a lot of this and kind of jokes about it. Like, there's a scene later on where he's like, maybe they'll be successful, or maybe they'll get eaten. Either way, it could happen.
That's the way of things.
He doesn't have a filter.
It almost seems like he just doesn't really care, like, in the long run.
Well, that's a good question, and do you think he feels like he's above them? Because there's another part later where he refers to them as your kind.
Hmm.
When he talks about, when we'll get into it a little bit later, but I just wonder if he sees himself as above.
He sees himself as separate, I think.
Separate and above, like, in not just Force knowledge and power, but maybe even...
On a different plane, you mean?
Different plane of existence, that kind of almost could be. Feel to him.
It's a possibility. Or it could just be that, for him, humans might have a lifespan where it's just...
insignificant.
Yeah, like, it's one of those things, like, they come, they go.
You're a fruit fly.
Yeah.
Yeah, precisely.
You're a fruit fly to me.
Yeah.
It's like, sure, you can try that. You might succeed, or you might die. Could go either way.
All right, so they tell him that, you know, we need the Sith Holocron. I like how the Bendu called the Sith Holocron the Keeper of Shadow Lore. Kind of a cool way of referring to the Sith Holocron.
Yeah.
And, you know, the Bendu reveals Maul's plan for the Holocron. Obviously, he says, he needs you to open up the Jedi Holocron because he wants to merge the Holocron.
Hmm.
And this is where we learn that...
It kind of sped up the storyline for the episode a little bit as well, just by going through the narrative of it.
It furthered the plot, because for the first time we find out that they're not just libraries of information. There's so much more. He tells them that. So they're almost... It's almost as if they're alive with the Force themselves. Like,
they tap into that entity almost directly.
Yeah, like something is put into them, you know.
Portal to it, or...
What that is and how it works, it's a mystery, obviously, but to us at this
point. Or if maybe the Force is on a separate plane happening all around us anyway, and that's like the gateway portal that can connect both worlds.
Conduit. Yeah, very deep, very deep. I like it. I like where you're going. So, you know, it just seems they're very deep. There's a lot more to them than just information.
Yeah, it does definitely seem like it's setting them up to be something you can kind of add to the mythology and lore and kind of use for storyline purposes down the line.
To me, it expands, this expands the universe even more. I mean, the whole new possibilities. I've always thought of holocrons as just like they said, libraries of information.
Just data storage.
Yeah, this is, you know, you might be able to get a lesson.
The holocron, a.k.a. USB drive.
precisely. It's the Star Wars equivalent. At least that's how I always thought of it. And now all of a sudden... Last season, the thing talks. So now it's
a USB drive with an artificial intelligence, now it's tapping into something greater than we know.
Right.
Yeah, now it's a portal.
Now it's a portal. It's something. Yeah. It's hard to say. So, then obviously Bendu explains that it's dangerous together. They can grant clarity and vision. Once again, this is where he says, beyond your kind. Beyond your plane of existence,
it might give you information that might overload your brain.
Yeah, it's like, to me, I kind of viewed it like, we live in a state of time, and I've often heard people explain that heaven is and God is out of time. It's that kind of
sort of thing. It's like a different
plane.
It's
out of our plane.
Yeah. Out of our plane of existence. Right?
Different plane, different way of seeing things, like seeing the bigger picture type thing.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, it definitely describes it in an almost religious fashion.
Yeah.
And I like how he said, you know, any secret wisdom or destiny can be seen through the Force. So anything you desire, it's literally like, aha.
Well, yeah, I mean, the Force has always been viewed as this thing that is everywhere sort of thing. So that makes sense that it has that sort of omnipresent, omniscient sort of thing going along with it.
Yeah, and he goes on and he says, you know, it can bring much chaos with such hidden truth. So to me, that's like, ultimate information equals ultimate power.
I think that's something we've seen even in our own history, is that for a long time there was a lot of people that guarded knowledge very, very heavily, because that was the difference between one tribe surviving and one dying off.
Oh, sure.
And I mean, especially once you enter into, like, warfare.
Yeah. Information is power. What do you think, Brian? Is it...
Yeah, I mean, like, a lot of shows have been doing that. Like, if you go back into a lot of the movies up until... like the last couple years, treasure has been treasure, gold and everything else, and money and everything else. And then now, all of a sudden, here in the last couple years, you've had several movies that treasure all of a sudden is wisdom or knowledge or...
Well, I think that actually makes sense for the generation that we're living in. I mean, you look at how information is now, and it is...
We're bombarded.
Not only overly abundant, but it's profitable. You can have more, you know, power and treasure from just bits of information than you can from...
And influence.
Yeah.
You can influence a lot more stuff. Just because you have money, you can't influence as well as you used to be able to because of the information that's out there.
Yeah, I mean, you look at, like, the political ramifications of, like... leaks, like either the Snowden leaks or like some of the hacks on the DNC or anything along those lines, and they have rippling effects throughout the entire government.
And when you think about it, so let's put it in our perspective, right, for just a second. So we're bombarded with information, we're bombarded with false information, we're bombarded
you have
with
information warfare.
So imagine suddenly being able to see the clarity through all of it.
Yeah.
And have the actual information.
Yeah, the actual information, the clarity, the truth. It's right there. It's right in your face.
Imagine tapping into something that is omniscient and just having a glance of that for
even a second.
Yeah. And don't get me wrong, you might have a hard time comprehending it and putting that into use, but if you could, it'd be amazingly useful.
Precisely. But, you know, he also, like I said, so, sorry, I kind of lost my spot out because we kind of went off on a tangent. But, again, so do you guys, the your kind comment, again, do you guys think he sees them as inferior, or do you think he's just trying to help them and just that they don't understand, kind of like a shaman? You don't get
possibly
it.
To be at the same time though. I'm still on the fence about whether I view him as more of like a force or spirit entity sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So he could just be referencing just a differentiation.
Brian, do you think he's using them? He sees them more as children, or just sees them as, like you said, fruit flies?
I'm sure he sees them as fruit flies as far as time span goes. But it's almost also maybe it's a brain capacity thing where humans can only use so much of their mental capacity.
Or there's limits to it.
Yeah, right. And maybe the Bendu doesn't have that. And he's like, so you're kind.
Right. Can only see so much, can only see so
far. He has a big head, so maybe he's, you know, he's a larger brain there as well.
Yep.
So, the Bendu also says he's seen this thing before. So, again, I think this begs the question, how old do you think he is? I mean, is he ancient? We're talking like thousands and thousands and thousands of years?
Most likely.
Oh, I think so.
Yeah, like not like Yoda's only 900, so this
guy's... Well, even that's still pretty good. Like,
yeah.
But, yeah, I would assume he's actually older than Yoda.
Yeah, very much so.
Do you think that because he's bigger than Yoda?
No. No, I mean, there's lots of small creatures that survive long times. Look at, like, turtles. Just ask.
I like how he called Maul a Darksider. Doesn't know much about him, but he says, I know his kind. So, you know, obviously he's run into a Sith, or at least understands it, because obviously he knows how to use it. So.
Yeah,
well, maybe that's what you're talking about before, like, why he's the only one. Because maybe they have run into the Darksiders before.
Yeah.
And so now he went to this planet
in hiding.
In hiding, basically, just
assumes the spiders will mess with anything that comes near him.
Yeah.
So I just, that begs the question: what legendary Sith has he run into that they could use him to bring in legendary Sith from the past? Because you've got fan favorites like Raven, you've got Darth Raven, you have Darth.
Depending Bane. On his age, you could actually make the argument that he could predate the Siths themselves and actually just be from a group of other dark side users.
From the dawn.
He might be the original Force user. And so he tried to train people, and half of them went to the dark side, and half of them went to the light side. Mm-hmm. And so he was there for the beginning, so he knows the light side, he knows the dark side, he knows their kind and what they want.
Mm. I can see that.
Maybe you have that.
That could be very cool if they go that route. I kind of like that idea, actually, that he's one of the first, or maybe the first.
Like his kind started the Force.
Or started manipulating and using it.
Understanding of the Force and everything else.
And passed it
on. And then tried to pass it on to a different culture.
Mm. A different race.
Different race. And then they saw
the potential for it.
Yeah.
Other applications.
This race took it to the dark side. Let's say this race took it to the light side. And then I wonder if, like, later on we'll see, they do, like, flashback scenes, and you'll see, like, a Bendu on Zeb's planet.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And teaching them how to use, like, a...
Oh, like how he tapped into, like, the Force to guide him through the one thing.
And maybe they tried to teach different ways to see which way caught on the best. And
well, either that or different cultures picked up on different aspects of it and interpreted it differently.
Well, that's what I'm saying. So maybe they started out trying to teach one...
And said,
and they went totally dark, and they said, okay, we're not doing that. Let's try this one. And they're teaching. Then they went light.
Mm-hmm.
And then they saw the other one, and they took it more of a holistic way. And, you know, maybe, I don't know.
Yeah.
Yep. So, very cool, though. Very good insight. So, the Bendu obviously says, well, the holocron is obviously a source of imbalance between you and your master. You must seek it out with them. Bendu seems very, very big on balance, obviously. Again, going back to the whole Jedi thing, but he's...
Hmm. Well, I mean, even going back to, like, when you first are introduced to the Bendu, he does kind of reference himself as being someone in between, like, the other sides of, like,
both the light and the dark. Yeah.
Like, so, he views himself as a very neutral, seeking balance sort of Force user.
So, does that mean that he prefers to keep the universe in balance, that he believes that there has to be both? And that in order to
most likely, yes.
To keep things
if he's viewing balance in that sense, as we have seen him suggest or
talking,
is that, yeah, he believes that both the light and the dark will exist, and you have to find a balance between the two of them.
What do you think, Brian?
Yeah, I mean, that's basically what we were talking about with being the gray.
Right.
He keeps equal amount of dark and light.
So do you think maybe that's why he's helping Ezra and Kanan right now, because there is a great imbalance at this point? In time in the Force? I mean, the dark side is everywhere at this point.
Like, rather than just being neutral himself, so he's actually
trying to balance it back out himself.
I don't know. I almost think he's just doing what's around him. Mm-hmm. And he knows that there's an imbalance between Ezra and Kanan. Mm-hmm. And that's what he's trying to even out.
He's trying to start there. Or you don't think he's maybe sensitive to the bigger
picture? He's not, like,
picture.
Working to a bigger picture sort of thing?
Yeah,
because...
I mean, he may be. I don't know. But for the way this seems...
Yeah.
He's more focused on those two and their imbalance and them become finding their...
Yeah, it doesn't necessarily seem like he's out to change the entire universe or anything. Right. I mean, he seems rather relaxed and, you know, mellow about the entire thing.
It's almost like it's almost one of those I don't give a shit type things.
Well, yeah, it really is.
And that goes back to the line, well, maybe perhaps they'll find balance. He's talking to that little slug. Or maybe they'll be eaten, such is the way of things.
Yeah.
That's life.
That's life. That's just how it is. the Bendu explains it's safe in the cave with the space spiders. Ezra says he'll go, Kanan, you stay here. Throughout this whole episode, and really since Malachor, Ezra is taking the lead, but he also seems like he's protecting Kanan. Well, yeah. Like, even on the ship, he goes first.
Yeah.
Or, you know, instead of taking Kanan along, he says, no, you stay here, I'll go. Mm. You know, I can see you can't. So he's actually protecting his master.
He's concerned about him because he is blind.
Yeah, because he still blames himself.
Right, precisely.
And they've talked about that several times in this episode.
Mm-hmm. So, when they first see the spiders, you know, lightsaber drawn, Kanan, get behind me. He even says, you know, get behind me when they're on their way to the Bendu. So,
yeah.
You know, there's another example there of him. And like you said, Brian, he still feels responsible for everything that happened. So, you know, even though Bendu warns him there's many twists and turns, and then Kanan says, I hear something. And then the Bendu kind of whispers over to Kanan and goes, ah, if you listen, you can hear it. Mm. So, where Ezra cannot, because of his blindness, he has these other senses.
Well, I think this is an extension of the Bendu kind of training Kanan to an extent. Mm. I mean, you go back to the last episode where he's allowing them to kind of reach out through the Force, and that's kind of an extension of the previous lesson almost.
Well, but Brian, what do you think? Same?
Yeah.
Okay. Kanan, I like how, even though, despite Ezra trying to protect him and all this other stuff, that he actually uses the Force, grabs his lightsaber. The Bendu asks, well, why'd you take his weapon? He says he has to learn to solve problems without it. That was very Empire Strikes Back-ish for me, where Yoda goes, your weapons, you will not need them, right before he sends Luke into the dark side cave, or whatever that is on Dagobah.
Right.
So, what, like the tree thing?
There's actually a cave underneath the tree. Then that's where he sees Darth Vader and all that, has the vision. So to me, I thought it was kind of a nice little nod to the Empire Strikes Back there. So again, you know, Rebels.
Well, that, and there's just probably connecting. It actually is pretty practical as well, because Ezra being aggressive towards the spiders kind of freaks them out. So giving him a tool you don't want to send him in with only a fly swatter, essentially.
Well, right, but yeah, he's saying he's going to have to learn how to do this, and I'm going to have to show him. So he's teaching him a lesson. So, obviously, Ezra gets in trouble, but Kanan enters in, and he shows Ezra how to keep the spiders at bay with the Force. Obviously, that shocks Ezra. He's like, how'd you do that?
Great line. Yeah, because even Ezra tried to connect with them because of his success connecting to other things like the squales.
The Force animal whisperer couldn't get it. And he's amazed by that. And I like the line from Kanan. He says, I've learned to see things differently since Malachor. Mm. Obviously, you know, nice metaphor. Everything that's going on. I thought that was kind of cool. Would you guys like that?
It was very cool.
Kind of a nice thing. Ezra, then eventually, you know, Ezra apologizes for Malachor, and, you know, Ezra, basically, they say, you know, I never blamed you. Kanan said, I never blamed you.
Yeah, like, it's the conversation he might have probably should have had with him before.
Right from
The conversation he had with Hera, and he said, I've never blamed him. She goes, tell him that.
Yeah, dumbass. So they hug and make up, you know, whatever. So eventually we see the Sith holocrons on top, the gathering of spiders. Okay.
Now, what the fuck was that? I have no idea. It made no sense to me at all.
Like, other than just
spiders had a cuddle party.
Yeah, like I could see the holocron being like on a rock in the middle of the spiders, or on the floor by the spider. Well, why was it sitting on top of one of the spiders?
To make it more menacing, I guess.
It made no sense.
Okay. I like how they use the Force to grab it, and he says, don't be a threat, you know, we go in peace, and he's using the Force the whole time. He's he's calming the spiders.
Yeah, he's just like, don't worry, I'm not going to kill you, you don't mess with me, I don't mess with you, we're cool.
Yeah, everything's fine. So, and then as soon as they get out, the Bendu says, your conflict is ended, perhaps balance is restored. Meaning, you know, there's probably more work to be done, but for now, you guys are good.
It's a step in the right direction.
But I like how he's right. As soon as he says that, he's right back. But your true struggle has only just begun.
Yeah.
And he's, you know, he goes about into how Maul will need the Jedi to open it up and merge and everything. So, I don't know. I like how they're using the Bendu, though, so far. He's very useful.
I found him to be, like, one of my favorite characters for this season.
Yeah, I'm really digging him. I mean, he's like Yoda to the nth degree. I don't know how to explain it.
It's a new interpretation of, like, that sort of character.
Yeah. And I like how he even goes on to explain that And that's where we hear, careful, once a secret is known, it cannot be unknown.
Yeah, I mean, he has that set up as, like, the price you pay for learning the secret is that you can't unlearn it, necessarily.
Exactly.
Which is kind of a fun, like, kind of twist of words, almost, but it's an interesting
note. So my thing is that secret that can't be unknown is Ezra's going to learn about everybody's death.
Possibly. Ooh, that could be. I think...
Because that's the big thing that Ezra's been talking about this whole so far is...
Like, what he's afraid of.
I'll never let my friends get hurt again and everything else, and now if he knows this secret... All of a sudden, he knows it's inevitable.
Mm-hmm.
It could be. The other thing, I think that I think, and we'll get into this more later, but I think people are going to want to know it, whatever his secret is, whatever he finds out.
Well, he had like little bits of it, but at least from like what Maul was seeing towards the end.
Well, we'll get to that, and I'm kind of holding back here, but I think people are actually going to hunt him down. Because they're going to want to seek, they're going to want to know what he saw. I think it's going to get out that they did this merge, and I think that...
I'm not sure if they're going to run with that storyline. They might.
You're not so much?
I don't expect it. Especially okay. Because, as like we were saying and trying to avoid towards the end, he does kind of look away and only gets... Well, he's not sure if he's seeing like bits of what he wanted to see or what Maul wanted to see.
Yeah, because he said, you know, he does say he saw different planets.
Mm.
Right, and
he doesn't say solid vents.
And I don't want to get too far ahead, but I just... Because I want to come back to it when we get to that scene, but to me, I just think that... I think people are going to want to know. I think when they do this, when they did the merge, it's sent out... Anybody who's Force-sensitive is going to feel...
I could see that.
So you think it's sent out a beacon?
It was like an explosion with rippling effects to the
but
Force.
But in that same extent, you could see people hunting down Maul for the same reason.
Well, right, then they might. And I think that's a plot point. And we'll go into that a little bit more towards the end of the podcast when we get to the scene. Real briefly, we see the group, Ghost crew tries to fight back against Maul. I thought it was kind of cool. I like how they open up with Maul trying to open the holocron.
Mm, just being very frustrating.
You will yield to my power.
Yeah, yeah, taking a very Sith approach to the Jedi tool. Yeah.
I thought that was kind of cool. I like they try to escape and they use his droid body against him. They magnetize him to the ceiling.
Yeah, and it really still didn't,
no match for a Sith, former Sith Lord.
It really didn't seem to help him too much. He was just like, okay, I'm upside down now.
Yeah, deflecting blasters and using his lightsaber. So obviously they get caught. But I don't know. I just thought it was kind of cool that they at least tried.
Yeah,
you know. But obviously
they try to be resourceful, and then he pretty much after they die, he pretty much just threatens them. You're only here because you still hold me.
Because you have value.
Yeah,
and I still need you. I don't know. I think it also showed that Darth Maul still has it. I mean that he. Yeah, not that I we think, didn't know that already, but it kind of.
I think pretty
it.
Much throughout the entire like Clone Wars and Rebels, I think that's been a more redeeming thing for him than the original like Episode One was.
Mm-hmm.
Like you see him be much more clever, being much more. Powerful in these episodes than you do any time in the film, so.
Yeah. Kanan and Ezra in the A-Wing, I thought this was kind of a cool scene. Kanan's like, well, you wanted it, now you got it. Here's the Sith holocron. If you want, just go ahead and open it.
Yeah.
And I like how he gives him the choice and he says
He kind of takes a step back and allows him to make his own decision on it.
Yeah, which is very... mentor, teacher, like, I thought it was pretty cool. And, he says, no, I want to hear what you have to say. And then Ezra's kind of taken back when Kanan says, well, we guess play it by ear. Mm-hmm. And he's like, you're taking this awfully lightly. And he's like, now we have to control our fear because it's our fear of losing our friends that Maul's going to use against us.
Yeah.
So very Jedi, stoic Jedi kind of
It also could be a reflection of, like, him kind of taking advice from Bendu, who clearly does seem to have a pretty relaxed demeanor about things.
Yeah. Well, I think that's part of being in the light, though, right? It's about being at peace, being calm.
Kinda.
Even Yoda says that to Luke, because Luke's like, how do I know the difference when you're at peace, when you're calm, you know, and you can, let the Force flow through you that way, not using anger or hate or fear, but, rather more peacefully, I guess. I don't know. What do you think, Brian? You think I'm off?
No, you're right. I'm spot on.
Okay. Okay, so let's talk about... My only problem I had with this whole episode, Maul throws Kanan out the airlock.
Really? I actually kind of like that bit.
Did you?
Yeah, like, I especially love the lead up to it. Like, when they're just having the conversations, like, I never meant to blind you, you know. He's like, yeah, you were trying to kill me, obviously. He's like, of course I was. I will kill you again.
Yeah.
At first you don't succeed, try again.
Yeah.
It wasn't the fact, that scene was cool. It was just the fact that he threw him out an airlock. And pretty much up to this point, Star Wars, you had to at least wear a mask to survive in space.
I don't know. Has that actually been a part of the canon at some point? Like, don't get me wrong, outside of, like, Vader being, like, in, like, one of the ships, like, going through space, you don't really see people in space.
No, you don't. And I mean, I did like that they put, like, ice forming on his beard and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah. I didn't even notice that realistic detail. Yeah, and his clothes crinkled when he came back in. You could see the frost on his clothes.
Well, I mean, it's always been more science fantasy sort of thing anyway.
I know.
The first time we saw it was what? Guardians of the Galaxy?
Where someone survived in space?
Like where we see the... when you're in space and it starts...
Your face starts to...
Starts to freeze and your clothes starts...
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I think the bigger thing that bugged me about maybe the scene is, how did Kanan not sense that from Maul? I mean, he's taking you aside. He's taking you away from Ezra.
Well, I think...
You're up against the guy who blinded you and tried to kill you before, and then you're suddenly caught off guard again. To be honest,
I actually think it kind of works just because up until this point, I was assuming that he was actually going to take Kanan aside for the one ritual thing, just... out of the assumption that it might actually damage Ezra, and he still wants to use him as a pupil?
Well, yeah, I think he absolutely wants him as his apprentice.
He definitely does.
And we'll get into that a little bit more. I think it's about him wanting a legacy. But.
Well, I think it was more the fact that the reason why it worked was because Kanan was so hell-bent on following the Bendu of...
Being at peace
and everything else. And everything.
The funny thing is, like, because he got thrown out the airlock and was able to jump back in, he kind of was able to save the day. Like, he pretty much was able to wing it, and like,
but
it caught him off guard because of that.
Right. Well, my thing is I think that's how he got caught in that position to begin with, and then he realized that there's a balance inside of him. He can't be completely one way. That's why when he comes back in, all of a sudden he's not out totally at peace anymore, and it's all back to kind of semi the way he was before. He still learned his stuff from the Bendu, but he still knows now you can't trust Sith.
Maybe back to reality. Mm-hmm. The only thing I could, because I was pondering the scene while I was doing the notes, and I was like, maybe they're still trying to show that Kanan is still vulnerable even with Bendu training. That's the reason for the scene.
Like, he's still, even though he's able to, like, grab Ezra, like, mid-explosion flight thing, like, he's still kind of learning the whole Force abilities thing while blind. He's not necessarily mission-ready as much as he wants to be.
Exactly. It's kind of like Brian was saying, same thing. So, maybe that's what it was. But that was really my only, with this whole episode, was my only thing. But
I don't know. Personally, I actually kind of like that scene, but...
Okay.
Yeah, I did too.
I'm glad you guys enjoyed it. That's cool. All right, so let's get to... the bread and the butter of the episode, the merging of the holocrons. Right at the bat, Maul asks his apprentice, do you comprehend the power you're about to unlock? Very Sith-like.
Yeah.
You know? And he surprises him, obviously, when he tells him, well, yeah.
Yeah, because the Bendu already explained it to him. He's like, oh, so you do know. Okay, this speeds up things so much.
And in typical Sith fashion, though, he goes, well, what do you want then? And he's like, well, you know what I want. I want to be able to destroy the Sith.
Yeah.
And he's like, as ambitious as ever. You know, he's still toying with him this whole time. He's still trying to get him to join him.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's part of what Maul is actually looking for in this as well, is allies. You clearly look at, even back to Clone Wars, he wanted allies to help take down, you know, his enemies.
Oh, yeah. And he was trying to do that with his brother before the Emperor.
And actually, speaking of his brother and the scene, towards the end of it, he goes, he's alive or we'll something like that.
And then takes off.
We'll get that.
Okay.
So... The one word, that, and Brian and I, we were talking about this even after the episode, and I said, it's bugging me. Maul says, I seek something more elusive, and he says, hope.
Mm.
That threw me for a frickin' loop. I was like, hope? What? Why would a Sith, albeit former, seek hope? Sith do not like Hope. They hate Hope.
Yeah, but I mean, through the Clone Wars and Rebels, we've seen kind of Maul's life story. He was, you know, kind of born out of, like, the weird magic sort of thing.
Right.
He lost his brother, was kicked out of the Sith,
He's had a lot of shit happen to him, but I just... at first, anyway, I was like, no, that goes against the Sith creed. There is no... love is a lie, you know. Hope is a lie. There is only power. There is only lust. There is only anger. My strength comes from my passion. All that stuff that's in the Sith creed. I was like, that goes against everything a Sith stands for. And I'm like, what the hell are they doing? I got to thinking about it, and it. Anyway, so...
It was Maul's search for Episode 4, A New Hope.
Kind of. Well, in some ways, yeah.
There's always a thing that... Even if you view Maul as a former Sith or a current Dark Force user or anything, not all people follow their guidelines as fanatically as others. I mean, there are going to be variants of that.
I realize that, but up to a certain point, it just... I was like, what are they doing? I mean, it bugged me for... It took me
a moment for a very dark character.
Well, the other thing was, is the way I looked at it was, when he's looking for Hope, he's not looking for Hope for himself. Mm-hmm. He's looking at Hope so he can destroy it.
Yeah. Well, kind of, yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm looking for Hope or whatever. And you're like, oh, really? Because I'm looking for whatever the thing is going to be to give other people hope so I can go and destroy it.
Mm-hmm.
So, I rewatched the episode. I actually watched this episode like 5 times.
No, not you.
Usually I only watch 2 to 3 tops.
Was there like certain scenes you cherry-picked more than others
by the fourth time? This one in particular. I actually rewatched this scene
several times
more. So,
I must admit I only watched it once.
So, as they merge the holocrons, Maul says, I see nothing. I see just oblivion. And then it hit me. I said, aha, okay, here we go. Sith can only exist in the physical realm. There is no life after death for...
What about
for the Sith?
Go back to Clone Wars. There's that one Sith user that's like existing in like a spirit form, right?
Darth Bane that's an illusion.
Oh, okay.
Yes, he's temporarily resurrected through the wills of the Force or whatever they are that are training Yoda. But other than that, no, they can't come back. They can't.
Whereas, you don't see them as Force ghosts in the same way you do with Jedi.
You don't see Sith Force ghosts because that is something that you gain not only through training, but it's a reward for living a peaceful, light side life.
I got to be honest, that is a very heavily Christian interpretation of
that. But that's how it is though, because it's you go back to I'll quote season 6 Clone Wars, the truncated season that they got. Watch the Yoda arc. Mm. It's all about that.
Yeah, I have watched. It's actually up there in terms of the arcs for Clone Wars as well.
Yeah, and that's where I said, okay, so that the price you pay for being a Darksider is you don't get to go on. There's only the physical realm.
So essentially you have lots of power, lots of strength now that you're tapping into, but it's not giving you anything beyond that.
No, beyond this, what happens is you're lost to the dark side.
I have a different theory. Finishers.
Okay, so like I said, it can't, you know, and it's also confirmed George Lucas has also said the same thing multiple times. So Maul's hope that he's looking for is purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Because when he's looking through the Force and through the merging of the holocrons, he says he sees oblivion. He don't see anything else.
Well, he doesn't see anything at first.
Right. But it's not until Ezra sees the vision, then he starts seeing Ezra's vision. Mm. He's not seeing anything for himself because there is nothing else for him at the end of the line. If you ask me, Maul is approaching the end of his time.
That is probably true.
Actually. We're in probably the end game.
Unless you have some weird thing where he ends up being Snoke down the line,
I hope not.
It'd be a bit of a stretch. Don't get me wrong, I'd find it funny, but it'd be a bit of a stretch.
That was my interpretation, is that the reason why Maul didn't see anything is because you can only see the secrets that will affect you, and Maul doesn't have much time left in reality or whatever. So his wanting to see something down in the future, he doesn't have anything down in the future because it's not there.
Right.
So when he saw Ezra's
vision,
all of a sudden he sees, my guess is his brother, But he sees him, and he says, oh, he's alive, and that's when he takes off.
Yeah, I'm making the same assumption that it's his brother that he sees.
Okay, I have a different assumption, because he's not seeing his vision, he's seeing Ezra's vision.
Mm-hmm.
And Ezra's question that he wanted an answer to was, what is the key to destroying the Sith? That's what Ezra's been searching for since beginning of season two. What's the key to destroying the Sith? And if you think about it, the key...
So you think it's Luke?
Is Luke. Luke Skywalker is the key. Without Luke Skywalker, there is no redemption of Darth Vader, who ultimately kills the Emperor and actually kills Darth Vader in the process.
Yeah, and essentially that's the end of the Sith.
And that's the end of the Sith.
Official context.
In an official context.
Yeah.
So by seeing...
Come wrong, you still have the Dark Force users. He goes on to be the First Order and all that, but yeah.
And because, and they even tease us with it, you know, where he says, I see twin sons, etc.
Right? Oh, that's true, yeah.
Right, so, which to me is Tatooine and Luke looking off at the twin sons. So what I think Maul sees is... Oh,
or he could be looking for Obi-Wan.
Right, I think Maul sees Obi-Wan, because Maul would recognize Obi-Wan.
Yeah,
oh, maybe.
Well, that and he wants to kill Obi-Wan.
Precisely, and that... Right. Because he's not just laughing happily. He's happy, he's angry, and he's happy at the same time.
He's fanatical. He lives.
You know, he's like, I'm going to, yes and no and you know, at the same time. You know,
oh, maybe because that was his purpose originally, was to get rid of
Obi-Wan. Was get rid of Obi-Wan.
It could be.
So,
destroy a rival sort of thing.
Precisely. So, you know, he's angry, he's happy. Kenobi is the reason he's still alive. So, therefore, he has to kill Obi-Wan. That's his purpose.
So would a Kenobi movie that they're talking about doing, would that be versus Maul?
It would be pretty cool if they went down that line. I think Rebels is going to play it out now.
Mm-hmm.
Not, it would be sweet if they had done that, though.
Yeah.
But unless they do something strange with that we don't know about. But to me, I think this will be the big finale for the season. If you ask me.
You think for the season or for the halfway point?
Maybe for the halfway point if they want to go that soon with it. But I think they're going to keep him around till the end of the season. Unless they're going to go to... Because I think mid-season is all going to be about leading into Rogue One. You're going to see characters that'll cross over. Maybe not major characters, but minor characters from Rebels.
Well, then, I mean, I think you also have to play with Thrawn a little bit throughout the season. Because I'm not sure if he comes back for another season or not.
Right, exactly.
Because we don't really know how many more seasons Rebel has left as well.
Well, we know there's another season.
Mm.
Okay. And so let's talk about Ezra seeing the key. Or let's just say that... I don't want to say I'm right, but let's just say that...
Did he see the key, though?
Well, yeah. He says, I see...
He said, I saw planets.
I saw planets.
Yeah, he also says
he
wasn't...
Some I recognize, some I don't.
Yeah.
So
he also mentions he says he's not sure if he saw his... request, or if you saw Maul's.
Right. Yeah. So, this is just my interpretation. But let's just say for the sake of argument that Ezra's seeing... Well, at some point, I think this season's all going to be about Ezra putting the pieces together to realize that Luke Skywalker is the key to destroying the Sith.
Mm.
And I think what you're... So, therefore, I think what will happen in Season 4, because we know they're recording a Season 4, is you're going to see... you're going to see Rebels jump from before A New Hope to after A New Hope.
Really?
In
it's
going to
make between season
after?
Three and season
yes.
four?
Yes.
It'll You're go, not going to see it like
it'll
during?
It'll go from being a prequel series to being a series set between... Season 4 will be set between Episode 4, A New Hope, and Empire Strikes Back.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
And
well, that's one thing we've never really known is whether... Like, Rebels continues on past that actual
Right,
film.
And I think they've made that choice. And the reason why I say that is I think there was a book that came out, and I think they're going to borrow it from it. It was called Shadows of the Empire.
Mm-hmm.
And Shadows of the Empire was all about the Emperor wanting to assassinate Luke Skywalker.
Mm-hmm.
So what I think they're going to do, and this is just me foreshadowing and...
I'm assuming that's before he was trying to recruit Luke Skywalker?
Right, right. Okay. Because you have to remember, between Episode 4 and Episode 5, he doesn't talk to Vader where Vader makes the suggestion, but if he could be turned, blah, blah, blah. Right now, all the Emperor probably knows is that Luke... He doesn't even know Luke's name probably yet.
So you assume season four is going to be Luke Skywalker just hanging out on his ranch, and then assassins keep trying to kill him, and then they interfere without Luke ever knowing about it.
Because that's what it was Shadows of the Empire.
Like, you're just Mr. Magoo.
Well, not necessarily so Mr. Magoo.
That's so weird.
Not so much Mr. Magoo, but...
Like, he's just there, kind of working on the ranch, and all of a sudden he just has this giant battle behind his back.
He goes to eat his cereal with his blue milk, and he bends over, and that's when the gunshot goes by his head.
No. Nothing like that, because you have to remember, I said, after episode four.
Mm.
So Luke, at this point, is nothing more than he's pretty weak. Mm. I mean, he's just a
beginner. That's basically true for the whole thing.
He's a beginner.
He kind of is, yeah.
Well, kind of.
I mean, you can make the argument maybe after
all right,
well, like the original trilogy, he gets stronger, but...
Yeah, all right. But from the end of episode four, okay, he's had about 2 seconds of training from
Obi-Wan. Yeah, he had a weekend Kenobi. Training session. That was it.
Well, he's had a training session on the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah, okay. with the light bulb.
Okay, that's
fair. The soccer ball.
That's it.
He had a weekend and a half.
So, what I think they're going to do is, I think that because Ezra will find out that eventually that Luke is the key to destroying the Sith, that he's going to protect him.
Mm.
And that because Shadows of the Empire goes into all the criminal elements of Star Wars, uses a lot of, that's where the Black Sun was first introduced. Mm. That's where all these
That's where Clone Wars picked up. That group then.
Right, that's where they borrowed it from, was from Shadows of the Empire. And that's why they call it Shadows, because it's stuff that happens in the shadows.
Mm,
and
underground
so
sort of stuff.
It's very feasible to put Rebels in that same group, because, Luke will be off with Han and Leia, but doing his thing. But in reality, they'll have the Ghost crew.
Doesn't that kind of go into that whole thing about how there was only so many Jedis at one point in the film franchise?
Well, sure, and it would make sense, too, because, we don't hear Yoda say Last of the Jedi to Luke until episode 6.
Oh, okay.
So you've got a whole bunch of time.
Okay, you can make the argument that if they died off before then, or if you're just counting them as Force users instead of Jedi...
Well, it depends on how you want to look at it, but even still, you can keep going between episode 4 and 5 for a couple seasons if you wanted to.
Okay,
they could actually do season 4 and season 5.
Yeah.
So, that's what I think. I think... they're going to take the Ghost crew, because in the Shadows of the Empire there was this one rebel, I can't remember his name, but who, that's what he does. He foils the plots,
mm-hmm.
protects Luke without ever
so
knowing.
So it just goes into like CIA sort of
kind of, yeah, they're going to be off on their own doing their own thing.
Okay.
Maybe helping the rebels too along the way, but in and out. But yeah, I think that's what's going to happen.
Oh, yeah. So. It's an interesting take on it. I mean, it could be pretty decent. If it's done well, it could be good.
Right, so I think I don't know. That's just my theory, and
I mean, it does kind of bring Rebels back closer to what you see almost in season one, in some ways.
In some ways, yeah, they're going to be part of the bigger rebellion. They're going to continue to help the rebellion, but Ezra's focus is going to be on Luke.
Yeah. Okay.
Because if he's the key, then he has to be, and he has to be protected.
You could look at it that way, or you could just look at it as setting up for, like, maybe Maul trying to kill Obi-Wan later on in the season.
Well, sure, but, I just think it's... I don't know, I think it's...
You think that ties into a larger plot that allows the show to continue a bit?
Larger plot, and don't get me wrong, I think Ezra's going to continue to be tempted by the dark side the whole time. He'll go back
and
forth.
Much any time you're focusing on any of the Jedi stories, you have that to a certain extent. Mm-hmm. Don't get me wrong, this show has loved to have that being a central focus, but... So you definitely will.
But that's just my theory. I don't know. Brian Wood, were you going to say? You said...
Said my different...
You thought it was his brother.
Yep.
Maul saw his brother. Mm. Okay.
Yeah, actually, that's what I was assuming when they first brought it up as well. But then you start talking about like the twin son thing. Is like I could see where that goes back to Tatooine and Obi-Wan as well.
I will say, though, I think they're going to screw with us all season, because I've already seen an episode for next week. And sure enough... the facility, the Wedge, or the TIE Fighter facility, it has two sons.
Does it?
It's pretty funny. I was like, they're going to screw with us all season.
Just the little things to drive the fans
just
nuts.
Just to throw you nuts. One other thing I thought that I think we should talk about real quick, briefly, that I thought was interesting. I like how Kanan was able to see kind of see for the first time.
Oh, like when the Force
when they merged.
Was, yeah.
When everybody else was so blinded by the light.
He makes the comment he was actually funny seeing through the
Force.
When
I was when I was watching it, I was like, wow, the soundtrack of this would be freaking amazing. Blinded by the light.
Yeah, it was very cool. I thought, I don't know, kind of maybe like you think Kanan may develop like Daredevil sight almost?
Well, I mean, he's developing the ability to see more heavily through the Force. And I mean, that's clearly what that light was just the Force, just spreading out sort of thing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it makes sense why that allowed him to see more when that's what he's been learning to do for the last few episodes, is being able to see through it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it goes back to what I was saying, where how the Force is on a different field.
Plane of existence.
Different plane of existence. It's all around us, mm-hmm. because it is us on a different plane. That's why you can see everything else. So, like, it's kind of like Daredevil, where Daredevil can hear stuff and... Like the really bad version.
All his senses, like, kind
of combined. Yeah, like the really bad version of Daredevil with Ben Affleck.
Where he has the actual sight.
Yeah, where he, like...
Where it's like the sonar thing.
Yeah, it's like the sonar thing. So he taps something and he can see the ripples effect hit off people. Mm-hmm. Or the rain coming down, he can see things. Similar with the Force. The Force is always bouncing off everything, so now all of a sudden he can still see.
Right.
Can't make out details, but he can see outlines.
Yeah, because I think that's what they're going to do. That's exactly what I was thinking, was the Ben Affleck Daredevil scene, even as bad as it was. I think it...
That part of it really wasn't that horrible.
Because it had its up moments. I actually like the actor that played Kingpin in it, but think the Netflix one did better, but
I think it was just so pure Force that he was able to see it. Yeah. I think maybe over time he might be able to.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if it actually does kind of go down that route, especially if it's you start seeing him, you know, taking more and more lessons from Bendu throughout the season, or you know, at least conversation sort of thing.
Yeah. Last thing, and I didn't put it in notes, just real quick to mention, if you, and only because I've watched this thing so many times. At the end, you kind of see both holocrons, and they both look on the floor, and they look broken. So, to me, that makes me think that these holocrons may not be able to be used again.
Like, by using them and tapping into this infinite thing, it just overloaded
the entire because you sense. See, like, their glass literally on the floor afterwards. Mm. So, I think they've been used up, essentially.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like having kind of a limit on using them that way would make sense.
Yeah, especially from a storyline, because you don't want to have them constantly using it to see things through the Force.
You don't want to be able to just constantly tap into, like, just infinite potential and just, like, win everything because of it.
Right. So
It makes it a pretty boring storyline.
Yeah, it does. All right, guys. Well, we've definitely gone through this episode. And once again, it was a half hour and we're over an hour now. So let's just go right into final thoughts and grades. Mr. Ankenbauer, your final thought and grade for episode 3.
For Holocrons
of Fate.
I'll give it 8 out of 10. It's definitely not my favorite episode, you know, since we've started watching Rebels. But there was a lot of story development and pushed a lot of things along. Like you said, kind of get you thinking about maybe how it's going to tie into Star Wars, which is like A New Hope. Which is what we've been trying to... We've been saying that from the beginning.
Yeah.
Like, how is this going to tie in? Is it going to be a side story, and we're going to see the Millennium Falcon and Han Solo as a side character in this one because it's two different stories going at the same time? So I do like that aspect of it. The only thing I didn't care about this episode was the holocron on top of a spider. I didn't really understand that, why it wasn't on... Like, I can see it being guarded by the spiders... But actually sitting on top of a spider...
A little bit over the top for you.
Yeah, a little bit over the top. It was almost as bad as when we saw the spiders last season. And the spider was, like, basically in the earth. And the legs were like a jail cell for the person in the thing.
Yeah.
Like, it didn't make no sense either, so...
Copy. So, bad use of spiders.
Yeah.
I'll actually give this one... I want to give it a 10 out of 10. I'm going to give it a 9.5 out of 10, only because... of the Kanan being thrown out into space, things still just bothers me, I guess. And the spider thing, I guess, a little bit. But other than that, what an amazing episode. It was talk about for being the second episode of the season, yeah, talk about just being in-depth, just so jam-packed. In fact, this episode, like I think we said at the beginning, it was, this episode had more in it, almost as much in it as the one-hour episode season premiere, and it really continues to expand the Star Wars universe and also connects things to the larger Star Wars story. Once again, I've said it time and time again that Star Wars is just one giant story told through different venues and different movies and different TV shows. It's just a giant universe and one giant story. But yeah, it's just it was a great episode. Loved it from beginning to end. Loved the idea of merging the two Jedi holocrons and expanding our knowledge of that and how that gives you clarity and sight. The Bendu is just absolutely amazing. Love it every second and looking forward to more of that as well. So so there's my final thought and grade. Aaron, what was your final thought and grade?
I'd probably give it somewhere around an 8.5 to 9 out of 10.
Okay.
It's a very solid episode. It fits a lot of things into it. Like we said, we've had most of the trailer already gone through by this episode. That, I love the Bendu as a character. I find that really interesting. I kind of enjoy the more neutral, almost gray type interpretation of the Force, or at least a character taking on that kind of perspective. We have Maul kind of furthering his own ambition a little bit throughout the series, and I think he's done better in Clone Wars and in Rebels than he has in the actual films, and he's been developed as a much more interesting character. So I always love seeing both those characters, and like, it was a very fast-paced, interesting episode. So I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I think it's just, it's going to set up everything. I think there's a high potential or very high likelihood of seeing Ben Kenobi. There's a very high likelihood of seeing Luke Skywalker now.
Mm. If you were going to have any complaint about this episode, it didn't really build on anything from Thrawn from the previous episode. But no. At the same time, I think you can take that at a slower pace without it really affecting the storyline too heavily.
Yeah, you know, I was not disappointed not to have Thrawn in this episode at all.
I thought it was a completely good, like, just Jedi-focused episode.
Yeah.
I think Thrawn will probably be used in the second half more so than
that. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I could see that.
And I have no problem with a slow burn on Thrawn.
Yeah. Building up the character a little better.
As much as I was disappointed in the first episode, not because I was wanting more, but I still want more, but I have no problem taking her time.
Well, it's funny, as far as rankings go, IMDb has episode 1, 1, and 2 at an 8.6.
Okay.
And then has this episode at an 8.7.
8.7, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just...
They do have the next three titles out if you want those.
Yeah, go ahead.
For the next episodes. We got the Antilles Extraction for next week.
Yeah, there's Wedge, yep.
And then Hera's Heroes.
Probably her father, maybe.
On
back.
On episode 4.
Okay.
And then The Last Battle.
Mm.
Episode 5.
That's interesting.
Well, technically it'd be 6, but...
So that would probably take us... Let's see,
October 22nd.
Through October 20, through the rest of October, almost. It'll be interesting to see where they go, especially in November, because that'll lead into Rogue One territory.
December. Which is kind of funny because after that it just goes episode 3.6, episode 3.7, episode 3.8. Like there's no
time.
It's actually not that uncommon.
Yeah.
For a lot of shows.
And I'm cool with that too because I don't know.
In some way it might be funny if it doesn't actually build up to Rogue One. Like, I feel like it'd provide better context for, like, some of the younger fans that want to go see it. At the same time, I don't know if they need to treat every spin-off episode in the same way they treated episode 7.
No, I don't think they need to, and I think you will see some crossover. It'll be like, if you only see the movies, you won't have to watch Rebels. Mm. But at the same time, if you do watch Rebels, you'd be like, aha!
Yeah.
You know, it's just like that you saw Guerrera from Clone Wars. You don't need to know that backstory.
Mm.
But... it'll be cool that we do know it.
You know, I've never looked at these rankings before on IMDb, but The Twilight of the Apprentice.
Yeah, probably a 10.
9.8.
Yeah.
That's it.
Shroud of Darkness, 9.2.
Mm-hmm.
Well, hey, what was the one with the squales?
Oh, I don't even remember the title. Yeah. It was about mid-season. Like, it was right before...
If it helps, the actual squales are actually called Pergrill.
Yeah, they didn't have them in here.
Anyway.
I want to say it was season 3, episode 6 or 7.
So, anyway, as season two, actually. But
oh, that was season two, yeah.
So while he does that, where can you find Four Midwest Guys? Well, you can find Four Midwest Guys by going to google.com, putting in the number Four Midwest Guys. There you'll find our Twitter feed. You'll find our Facebook page, our email accounts, all that things. Please reach out to us. I know I said I would do this. It was on the YouTube page. We found out that...
you had a couple comments.
Yeah, there was a couple comments. Brian, can you pull that up real quick? But we had a couple comments from our...
on the YouTube page?
Yeah, because I lost the YouTube page on my computer for some reason.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, it was... we'll mention the user's name here briefly, but we found out that it was the other person that would possibly be Sabine's mother was Rusk, who was actually in the Clone Wars, another female Mandalore. She just never took her helmet off in that whole season 5 episode. And he also had another comment. But we really appreciate those comments. We love those comments. We love the feedback. Tell us if we're doing a good job, not such a good job. We want to know. Please reach out and tell us. We've got other shows coming down the line, Marvel DC Kings, which will probably premiere next week, and we'll go in depth with all the countless number of comic book shows that are coming out. The Flash, Arrow, was it Days of Future?
Days or Legends of Tomorrow.
Legends of Tomorrow, Supergirl, which I'm actually going to give
another chance.
It's on CW.
I can't find it for some reason. I mean, I've got our feed up, but I don't see.
Did you bring up the actual episode? It's in the comments below.
Which episode was it?
Episode.
It our preview?
Our season 3 preview.
Was it? It that one, or was it the season 2 finale one?
No, it's the season 3 premiere.
Oh.
Because it's where we talk about.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, here we go.
Swarzer
Blitz.
Swarzer Blitz. All right, thank you for reaching out to us. And
he said, the second female Mando you're talking about is Rook Cast.
Rook Cast, that's it.
Lightsaber Blade also says, lightsaber blades do have weight, a few dozen grams at most. The blade of the lightsaber is made up of superheated gas locked in an electromagnetic field.
Ah, so there you go, Aaron. Little physics for you.
There was
a Star Wars Universe
outcome. Yeah.
What was his name again? Well, you took it down. All right. Well, we thank you for those comments, sir. And please continue to reach out to us. All right. So,
One other thing.
Yeah.
On Twitter.
Yep.
You know how I've been posting all those. I do a lot of those toy things with the Dorbs and the pop.
Yes, the pops. Yeah.
I actually won.
Did you win one?
Yeah, I won one. It was a Captain America. Sepia Dorps Anniversary Edition.
Ah, sweet.
Yeah, so that should be coming. They said it would be a little bit because they're at New York Comic Con.
Oh, that's right.
Right now,
that's
big this weekend, so it's putting everything on hold, so I'll probably get that the next 2 weeks or so.
All right, cool. Well, it's been a really good show, and thanks for joining us, Brian.
Thanks for having me, man.
Thanks for joining us, Aaron.
Yep, no problem.
And for B. Willie saying, may the Force be with you always.